Hey everybody, this is Rustin with Metal Nation, and today we're joined by Tobias Sammet of Avantasia and Ed Guy, the Jim Steinman of heavy metal. How are you, my friend?
Thank you very much. I'm fine. I'm great. Thanks for having me. Thank you.
Absolutely. It's always great to get a chance to catch up. Moodglow comes out February 1st, marks the band's 8th album, 20th anniversary of Avantasia. I thought you were taking a break. Instead, you build a studio and create another brilliant record.
Thank you. Well, I thought I was taking a break, but you know, the break didn't really last for very long. I was just making the decision I have to slow down a little bit, and I did slow down. Don't get me wrong, I did slow down. It doesn't look like I did, but I did. And the difference was, I was working, but I was not working according to a schedule. I was not working to meet a deadline. I was not working to deliver any product in particular. I was just working by myself, for myself, without a certain purpose. And yeah, built a studio and just you know, wrote music, and I was creative and recorded it and did demos, and I thought maybe it's going to be a solo record or something like that. But then I looked at the material, or I listened to the material, and I thought, well, it sounds like Avantasia, and, well, what's the difference of a solo project in Avantasia anyway? Avantasia is a solo project, just with a couple of guest musicians, and it's just a huge solo project. In brief words, I was in the middle of recording a new Avantasia record, and it felt good, and it didn't feel as stressful as it had in the past, so... Yeah, I took a lot of time, and I was a little bit slower this time. It took some months more, but here I am, and the result is great, isn't it?
It is. It's a wonderful record. And you've always gone your own way, done your own thing. You're sort of a master of celebrating the abnormal, if you will. You always seem to do it at such a high level, though. How do you keep that energy and fire of creativity roaring?
Thank you for your nice words. I mean, that's very kind of you. You know, I think... The foundation of everything is enthusiasm and conviction, and following your conviction and trying to listen to your intuition and do things for the right reason, which is not to be flavor of the week or deliver anything that would suit or fit a certain market or target audience. The thing is, you have to really be a little bit stubborn and, well, old-fashioned in a way. You know, that's what they told me. Some when I try to get a record deal with this record, some other record companies, a mainstream record, major record companies said, it's a little bit old-fashioned. It's not really fashionable. Yes, exactly. Thank you very much. It's not fashionable. I'm not flavor of the week. So you have to do what you believe in, and you have to have a certain capacity for suffering, and you have to be well prepared that you will get some flack for doing what you do. You have to be ready to take that flack, and I think that's enthusiasm is the core of everything. I try to be enthusiastic about things, and if they don't really excite me, I do them either differently or I don't do them at all. And some people would call it stubborn, but I think that's the most honest approach that you can have as a musician. Do what excites you, otherwise you will fool people, and people don't want to be fooled. And I think that's pretty much my work ethic in a way. I'm honest, and if I fail, I honestly fail, and if I succeed, I honestly succeed, but it's always heartfelt and stubborn in a positive way, I think.
It all turned out beautifully with Moodglow. So let's talk about the homunculus. Tell us about the concept of the new record. It seems like a very personal and cathartic album for you.
Absolutely. It's a very personal album. I try to come up with a concept that would give me the opportunity of writing something fantastic, but at the same time, I wanted to incorporate my own feelings. I wanted to get things off my chest, and at the same time, not just write it as a blatant, soul-stripping thing. I wanted still to wrap it up in a fantastic environment, and I came up with that concept that was heavily influenced, I think, by the Victorian revival of the Gothic novel, and Gothic novelists like Mary Shelley or Edgar Allan Poe or the Victorian revivalists of the Gothic novel like Arthur Machen and Algernon Blackwood, etc. I came up with a story about a creature that has been created and cast and placed into an environment, into a world where it can't find a place for itself. There is simply no place for it. It doesn't belong, really. It can't cope with its environment, with its surroundings. It can't cope with the expectations of the bold and the beautiful, and it can't cope with a harsh daylight, with a harsh reality of what is widely considered to be beautiful and normal. And therefore, it turns to the dark, and it wants to escape, and it wants to be invisible. And that's a classic topic, I think, that would work well in a gothic novel, dark romanticism world. But at the same time, it gave me a feeling, because it's some of it is very, very autobiographical. And it gave me the feeling, it gave me the opportunity to incorporate my feelings and to get things off my chest and write about my experience, because I had come right out of a tour with Ghost Lights 2016. It was a very, very successful tour, but I was a little bit battle-worn, I have to say. And I was looking back on quite a heavy load of work and many things that I had done in the previous 20 years, you know, speaking of 17 albums and that I had written pretty much most of them, or most of the stuff on the albums. And I'd done 10 world tours within 15 years and done all the promotion and the organizing, and I'm managing both bands, Edgar and Avantasia. So it was quite hard. And I was more and more getting the feeling that I have to deliver something. And I was just in a treadmill living up to expectations. And I needed to slow down. And I was, you know, also, you're in a certain way, you're always in public, and people look at you, and people have certain expectations, and they demand certain things, and if they don't get what they demand, they can be really harsh. All these little things, they bleed through in your mental world, and I really had to get certain things off my chest, and the whole album, it pretty much deals with expectations, but also with conviction, and with also going your own path, and also with having to be a little bit stubborn at times. Or not a little bit. You have to be really, really stubborn and listen to your intuition and not give a shit about certain people's opinion in order to maintain your sanity. And these are all topics that are wrapped up in the story. It's a very coherent story, and at the same time, it's 10 individual poems, and each of them offers a different aspect of that one huge thing, entity, that is Moodglow.
And one of the things that I had picked up on in listening to all of this was it sounded like it was sort of cathartic for you, sort of a therapy, if you will.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was. I was writing about things that were that I had on my mind, and it felt good. You know, it's just like sometimes everybody knows it. Everybody who's got a driver's license, you will sit in your car. I don't know. Maybe I'm abnormal, but I sometimes sit in my car and I talk to somebody. I don't know who I'm talking to. You know, just I'm talking to myself to get things off my chest, to phrase things, to let them out, to put thoughts in the right order. And I think art is about all that. Not only the words, also the music. Sitting at the piano and playing and just playing around with it and not playing a certain song, just playing around and letting things come out of my fingers or mind or whatever. That's also getting things off your chest, and that's what art is all about. And that's why, you know, if you deliver something bite-sized just for the plain reason to deliver something in time for a certain purpose, to make a certain amount of money, to recoup a certain budget, to appeal to a certain group of fans, I think then it's not, to me, it doesn't really work. I mean, to a certain extent, that may work, but to me, that's not what I think my art is supposed to be, I think, in a way. I want to play things that mean something to me, and I want to get things off my chest. And that's why I think, of course, music is a therapy, in a way.
With Ghost Lights, which was absolutely one of my top two albums of 2016, you completed a two-record storyline before that, the three-album trilogy. Are you starting a new story arc with Moodglow, or is this sort of a standalone tale, or is it too soon to tell? Because knowing you, you probably already have half another record written already, so...
I have more than half a record written already. It's like the working process. It was really paradox. It was weird because I planned not to do anything. I intended to have a break. I built my studio when I, you know, slowed down. But all of a sudden, once I had made the decision that I'm not going to work against a deadline, all of a sudden, ideas kept flowing and I kept capturing them. And I wrote so many. Some songs are done. Some are half done. Some songs have been released now on Moodglow. There's certainly going to be Moodglow Part 2 at some point. And they certainly belong together, Moodglow Part 1 and Moodglow Part 2. But I don't know really when that is going to happen. I have a lot of stuff finished, but right now, I don't really want to think about the future because I'm 41 years old now. I have been in the music business for 27 years now. Yeah, when I was 14, I started Edguy. I just had turned 14. We founded Edguy, and I've always worked. I've always lived in the future. I've always looked at the next years. What's the plan? Let's do this. Let's do that. And I really think that Moodglow is a result of, for the first time in my life, I didn't have a plan. I think that's where why Moodglow sounds so relaxed in a way, and embellished and detailed and lovely and intimate. Of course, flamboyant in some moments, but also intimate. So right now, I don't really want to live in the future. I don't want to think about, oh, the next album's going to come out in 5 years, the next Edguy record in 3 years or whatever. I don't really care right now. I can't really care right now.
Well, it's got to be nice having that studio, though, right there, because you can really fulfill anything you want to in in an immediate sense. So, but
absolutely.
Yeah. There are some new faces, as always, some familiar faces, but some new voices on Moodglow. Tell us about putting this record together and how you chose some of those new voices, like Hanzi, Candace Knight, and Millie Petrozza.
Millie's a good friend of mine, and of course some people may think that creator, it's a different world, and they're probably right, because, I mean, we're more this epic rock or old school heavy metal in some passages. Creator are thrash metal, old school German thrash metal. Of course, it seems like it's a different world, and musically it is a little bit different. But Mila and I have been friends for very, very, very long, for I think probably 20 years, something like that. And we've always spoken about him being part of Avantasia, but there was never the right song. And this time I had the right song. I knew immediately when I had that part, and I was mentally going through certain names and trying to find out who could be the right vocalist for this. It happened real fast that I knew that it's going to be Mille. And yeah, I wrote the passage, I sent him the track, he went in the studio, recorded it, no big deal. With Hanzi, it was pretty much the same thing. Hanzi Kirsch of Blind Guardian and I have been friends since 97, I believe, when he was contributing vocals and also some arrangement skills and advice that he gave me for the Edguy record, Vainglory Opera. And I wanted to have Hanzi for the first Avantasia record originally, but back then he wasn't available. He was doing something with John Schaefer, with Demons and Wizards. They had a project together, and I think they still have that project, or right. They have it again these days. So they were working together, and I think he was quite busy, so it didn't happen, long story short. And I always knew at one point I may, or at some point I may work with, may want to work with Hanzi again. And I had that song, The Raven Child. I called him up and said, Hanzi, now it's the time. Do you want, or could you imagine? And he listened to the track and he immediately agreed. And it wasn't really a big deal. I'm really happy, of course, also about all the guests that I've worked with before. It's sometimes I get asked, You brought in so many people that have been working with Avantasia before. So are you running out of ideas for new guests? Now the truth is, it's not about the gimmickry. It's more about the quality, and it's just things that are really, really close to us and people that are close to us. We sometimes tend to take that for granted, and I don't want to take that for granted. I have had the chance in the past also to work with some of the greatest vocalists and most legendary vocalists in heavy metal and rock music. Some of my all-time idols, And I don't want to take that for granted. I'm really thankful that people like Jorn Landy or Eric Martin of Mr. Big or Michael Kiske of Halloween or Jeff Tate, that these people have worked with me before and they agreed to work with me again, and there's friendships in between us. And it's just great and stimulating, you know. You're sitting at the piano and you have a song in mind and it sounds like an Avantasia song, and then all of a sudden you have Jeff Tate in the back of your mind and Operation Mindcrime and Empire and all these great records, Rage for Order, and it's too good to be true. All of a sudden it stimulates, it tickles my imagination. And I write a song, and when I wrote those songs, Alchemy and Invincible, for example, and I knew Jeff would sing them because he had agreed to being a part of the new Avantasia album and tour. That's an amazing, uplifting feeling, because first and foremost, I'm a fan myself. That's the foundation of composing and producing music that will have an impact on others. It has to be something that excites yourself, not only as a music producer, but also as a fan. And, you know, there is nothing like being in a studio with Jeff Tate and having that legendary singer that inspired hundreds of thousands of heavy metal singers, to have this guy next to you and, you know, do his magic with a song that you wrote. That's amazing. And that also goes for Ronnie Atkins of the Pretty Maids or Bob Catley of Magnum. It's just an uplifting feeling.
Absolutely. And for fans, I mean, we want to hear the great talents, and you've chosen some of the greatest, so why would we not want to hear that on every record? Jump to the U.S. tour real quick before we get out of here. You're going to be doing a little mini U.S. tour. Thank you very much for that. Who are you going to be able to bring along with you on this one? I know it's a little bit more difficult coming to the U.S. than it is playing over in Europe.
Yeah, but it's just these days it's just a stone's throw away, and it's real. It's not that difficult, actually. And we're going to do the full show. We're going to play around 3 hours. We're going to do old stuff, new stuff, and it will be an epic undertaking. It will be I always say it's like, because we have been compared to something like TSO. Somebody made a comparison, said, oh, it's the European version of TSO. No, it's not. We're the grotesque, ugly, wicked brother of TSO, you know, the mean version of it, the dirty version of it. We're the Tim Burton version of something Disney-ish. But I like TSO, don't get me wrong. Don't want to badmouth it. So we're going to bring, there will be Jorn Landy, there will be Eric Martin, there will be Ronnie Atkins, Bob Catley, Jeff Tate, Herbie Langhans, Olli Hartmann, Sascha Pärt, Miro Rodenberg, Felix of Edguy. I will be there. Adrian Cohen, a great female vocalist from the States. She's an amazing singer. She's so versatile. Yes, it's going to be a great thing, and I'm really proud. And, of course, it's a brief U.S. tour compared to a Kiss farewell tour. But for us, you know, it's just I think Avantasia tours are always quite brief, because you only have such a certain time frame of maybe 8 weeks, 10 weeks, and you have to cover the whole world with it, because right, everybody's got their individual schedules with their own bands. So doing 4 shows in the States, it's more than we do in France and England and Russia and Japan and Australia. So it's quite, for us, it's quite a long tour in the U.S.
Well, I'm looking forward to catching up with you at the L.A. show, getting a chance to see it. Thank you so much for continuing on. I mean, it's important to have those breaks and regroup, but you've put out another fantastic album, and of course the fans would love to hear new Edguy, but take it as it comes, because that's when you're at your creative best, and we appreciate the genius of it all.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And, well, yes, see you in Los Angeles. I'll be there.
All right.
We'll be there.
Take care, Toby.
Take care. Thank you very much. Have a great day.